and some very good attendance. And we certainly hope that we'll see all of you next year at our meetings. And I don't know if they've gotten around to all of you, but there's a blue sheet floating around for all of you that you can take a look at. There's a brief review of 2011. I just got this myself. Tentative programs for next year. We were unable to get to Schiller's Barn this year. They had some personal problems. And we had a very good meeting, if you recall, with the Michigan Pike people. There were 80 people there. Lakewood is going to be 100 years old next year, and that's quite an amazing story as to how Lakewood came into being. It was a promotion from Chicago newspapers, as was Fruitvale, and then the other ones you can see we have on there. At this time, Jim is still bringing in chairs. Thank you, Jim. This time, we're going to kind of break the business aspect of things up because we've got a program that we want to get right into. And I'm going to ask the slate of officers for next year to stand, and we're going to get them elected. And then at the end of Roger's program, we'll ask them if they'd like to say something for 37 seconds. And then we have some other business to attend to, which shouldn't take very long. For president, we have Ron Arnautz. Would you just stand, let people see who you are, Ron? Vice President, Tristan Scholl. There he is. I saw him just a second ago. For treasurer, James Haley. He's already standing. James is the one that brought all the chairs in, so you could sit down. Our historian, and Roger Sharmer. Right there, you're going to be hearing him in a second. And John Robillard, our membership corresponding secretary. At this time, if there's anyone that would like to nominate someone else, or if you personally are dying to hold one of these positions, speak now. I'm entertaining a motion for nominations. Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to cast a unanimous ballot. Yes.
I will so move.
Okay. It's been moved by Tom Thompson that a unanimous ballot be cast for the aforementioned candidates. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. There's a second. And those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Richard Daly would be proud of me. Okay. Now, with that, we will move to, we're going to do that after program round. We'll let everybody say a couple of things, okay? With that, we'd like to move to the presentation of
the awards.
The awards for, these are structures, houses, correct? Mm-hmm. Okay, Roger and Lois.
Lois is it.
Our official representative from Chicago. Now, Lois is a lifelong White Laker.
Right.
And come on up here, Lois. And
I want to pass this around. These are the three houses that we are presenting awards to tonight, and I thought I'd just pass it around and let you look at them while I introduce the people. Unfortunately, one of the couples I don't know. Would you have, not you, Ellie Dennis called just a little while ago. And she's ill, and she had talked with the Oxenhams. Is Gary Oxenham here? Oxendale, excuse me. Oxendale? No? Too bad. Well, they have a lovely house over here on Spring Street, I believe. And it's the house that Wally Wiese had moved from Colby onto the area. And it's a good example of a four-square house. First of all, let me explain that every year the organization gives awards to the structures in the area that we deem worthy. Oh, thank you, Bob.
worthy of recognition. And I say structures, not houses, because we have given it to Dog and Suds, the Paisley Place, several of the bed and breakfast. Well, they were houses. And these structures reflect an effort on the part of the owners to maintain and preserve and restore some of the buildings that we think are significant in the area. And I think they should be very proud of them. And we hope that this will be an inspiration for other people. So first of all, I'd like to introduce the Slagers. Dave and Christine, would you come up, please? You can bring up Ian if you want to. Could you tell us a little bit about your house? Dave talked to me on the phone the other night, and I thought it was interesting, so how about it?
Well, we moved into our home in 1993, and We moved into our home in 1993, and it was a real fixer-upper when we bought it. We were just a newly married couple in our 20s, and just starting with our family. And so we knew we had a treasure, but we didn't know what to do with it. But we knew we didn't want to do anything that would, you know, demolish the outside of the home or anything with the siding or the windows. Although we were severely tempted with all of the snow inside the windows to get them just done over when we were young kids because we were just freezing. But we never had the resources to do that, and thank goodness, because, you know, now at the point where we actually could restore the home in a proper manner, we were able to keep all of the wood intact, all the siding and all of the window decorations. And we had found out a little bit about the house from people who used to live there, who actually came by when we were first in the home. And they had lived there in the 50s, so they had given us quite a bit of a background of what they encountered when they moved in. And one of the things that they said is that they installed baseboard heating, because at the time that they moved in their house, they had one central stove that they had to feed with wood, and there was a grate in the ceiling right above it to keep the upstairs warm, and that was it. So he put electric in the upstairs, and he put baseboard heating throughout the house, which we are very grateful for. There is no venting in the house, though, so there's no forced warm air in the house. But we do have the baseboard heating, which is very nice. They, at that time, also gave us a copy of the abstract of the house, which, as a genealogist, I'm very interested in, because it goes back to 1848, when the government owned Montague as one plat of land, and then they started subdividing it to the lumbering companies. And you can see going from the government to very large strips of land, you know, coming down into White Lake area. And then you see it divided to people like Noah Ferry and people like that. And then in the 1870s, it was subdivided into just single family plots. And our home was probably built, I think, by between 1877 and 1878, because we've noticed that there is a outline on one of the plats in the Montague Museum for right where our house sits, and there's a house drawn there. So we know that at least it was there in that era. The people who helped us with our home to restore it, some of them are very knowledgeable about structure and how it was built, and our window guy said that he could tell that our home was built in several different parts, and he could tell by the foundation how it transgressed from one, like, old brick, or what would you call those, the big stones that were all, you know, cemented together, and then you see them progressing to different types. That was kind of neat to look at that. And he said that the flooring we have in our home is an extinct, it's like a yellow, long yellow pine is what he called it, but they don't have it in that length anymore. So he said, while yellow pine forests grow, they're not that tall. They deforested that whole, so it's neat to know that we have, well, neat. I mean, it is extinct, but it is nice to know that the yellow pine in our flooring throughout our house is, you know, something sought after, because a lot of people don't, you know, have that kind of flooring left in their home. Maybe it was removed or whatever, or covered over. So, and we decided that in when we wanted to do the painting and whatnot, we wanted to make sure that we were doing it properly. So we were put in touch with Paul Potter, who worked diligently with us to make sure that the colors of our home were appropriate for the age, and we researched, you know, what colors and tints of paint were used in that era, and the, so on and so on. So we made sure that we wanted to keep it as accurate as possible, you know, color application, where in the home was that color applied, you know, don't put a dark color where a light color should have been, that kind of thing. He had to put up with us for quite a bit, because we had really opinionated about how we wanted it exactly to be. But so we were just so happy, you know, that we were able to do the restoration, and we're happy that people can enjoy it as well. You know, we're happy that it's solid and back to, you know, not a fixer-upper anymore. But yeah, we're. And if you wanted to drive by, we'll wave from the window.
And you'll recognize the house, because I hope you'll put this up on the the wall.
We will. Thank you. It's on Mead Street, at the top of the Montague Hill on Dowling. If you turn immediately left at the top and go down one block, the Montague Museum is right there on the corner. If you keep going the next halfway down on the right-hand side.
With this plaque on the porch. Yeah. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Roger, can you introduce the sure. next person?
Yeah, the next person is, this is a house on, it's the red brick house that you see on the thing that's being passed around. And it's Gail Baxter Montague. And I went over to Gail Baxter's house a couple times, again and again and again. The driveway was always, the car was parked there. The light porch light was on. No one ever responded, and I thought, oh my gosh, you know, is there somebody inside, or what? Why isn't something moved, etc. And then she finally called and said, I've been back surgery. I'm in Heartland, and I'm in a wheelchair. So, Gail Baxter, come on up. Actually, the house is an interesting red brick. There's a lot of yellow brick houses around, but not many red bricks. And maybe you can just give us a few little comments about the building, and Lois will give you the award.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. If I stand up, I'll fall on my face.
No, don't do that. I'm gonna
sit here. A lot of the information I have was from John Lettick, and I used to keep in close contact, and he told me some of the information on my home. And I've been there about 19 years, and it's got some interesting features that you might not know that are a little unusual about houses. And quite often in the summer I have tourists stop and they take pictures of it. So it's kind of a neat little house, mm-hmm. and they all fall, everybody falls in love with it. But the inside I have remodeled almost totally, and I've turned it into a Victorian home, and raised the ceilings back up to 10 feet, and I'm paying for that, but it's pretty. And so we have a couple interesting features where I think there's a couple graves out in the yard, because when the snow melts in the spring, the ground sinks into perfect rectangles. And the strange thing about those two graves is that, if they are such, is that the flowers are growing on both of them. So that's kind of cute. And I have grandchildren that will not spend the night because they are totally afraid of how spooky it is, which it is. And a granddaughter I raised from birth, who always talked about the young man who lived there with us. But I only saw a shadow once, so I can't say I know him personally. But the back of the house has yellow brick. Roger talked about the front being red brick, and it is, but the back where the kitchen is yellow brick, and apparently when the Franklin House burnt down, mm-hmm. that was yellow brick, and you can see the brick was carried from downtown up there to the corner of Hunton Park, and they added on a kitchen. So the kitchen, the outside of the brick is smudged with dirt, with smoke. You know, so that's kind of interesting. So the house is red and yellow brick, and I've repainted the trim and painted the garage, and my neighbors all said, "You're crazy, you're painting an orange garage," but it worked, and now they like it. So there, the house is said to have been an Underground Railroad house, and we have pictures that have been taken of the house, and the one window up in the attic where it's a round window, where a candle would be, you get a glow around it in the pictures quite often. An aura all the way around that one window, which is kind of neat too. But the house is apparently 170 years old. I'm 70, so the house has been 100 years older than I am, so I'm told, because I've never really read this thing here, the abstract on it. I've not had time. So, but it's old. The glass in the windows is very neat. I had to order special all of the window trimmings because they're tall and skinny, and the glass has slid down in them, so it droops. It's real neat to see glass droop. I never knew it could do that. So that's interesting. The man who lived there, it said it has all the important names of the people in town, Montague, William, and the streets and so forth. And the first man who lived there, they said he built it as a workhouse for his Red Mill, one of the first logging mills at the mouth of the river. And so tourists come, they take pictures of it. It's just it's a nice old place.
Well, you've done a wonderful job.
Well, thank you very much. And I want one of those.
Yeah,
isn't that nice?
You've got one. And, you know, yours is the first haunted house we've given an award to.
Well, also, there's one other thing I forgot to say. Now, this does not make sense, because I have a picture in here that is in with the abstract and that, of a man who apparently was president for a day, and they say he lived there, but it makes no sense unless he was a logger. Why would a man of such importance live in such a house?
Thomas Ferry.
You know that? Because I have his picture is in here with his stuff. So, yeah.
He was senator?
Oh.
Well, enjoy this, and thank you for coming out tonight.
Isn't that beautiful?
Some interesting things.
Yeah.
So thank you very much. And we'll see to it that, does anybody know the Oxendales in here? You do?
We know them.
Well, they said that they were going to try to come tonight, and I'll make sure that they get this, but tell them that we talked about them tonight. Thank you.
That house that Lois talked about, the Four Square, that was also a Sears house. And if you, there's two or three books out about Sears houses. They really were premier houses. The Chicago Tribune had an article a couple of years ago, the north side, the west side of Chicago, some of the suburbs where there's a lot of Sears houses, actually had at that time, that was before I think the real estate market crashed, actually had bidding wars for some of those houses, people wanting to get them and restore them. So very interesting. We're going to move into our program with Roger. And after the program, I want to tell you that we're going to introduce the new officers. I said a year ago I would do this for a year because they didn't have anybody who was wanted to be president. And we've kept it going. And there's been some. This is a great organization. If you're not a member, I encourage you to. You meet a lot of wonderful people. I mean, I've gotten to know Roger through this. He's probably saying, look, Lois, Ruth, and on and on and on. And we've had great meetings over the years. There's more good meetings scheduled for next year. Tom Thompson brought in some sweatshirts, and this time of year, you certainly don't want to have a shortage of your sweatshirt supply. He'll give you a good deal, and he's got some posters, and look at that stuff. And we have two items of business to conduct at the end of Roger's presentation also. I'll just tell you, one is regarding some funding for the digitalization of the Montague Observers. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Roger. Now, Roger conned me into this back in the 90s. And he said, well, we really need someone to be da-da-da-da-da for the Historic Society. And there's really nothing to it. You just da-da-da-da-da-da. And he also conned me into being on the County Museum Board. You know, he said, oh, you know, didn't know him to do that. But Roger is a real treasure. He really knows a tremendous amount of these things. And if you have heard this term lately, because I've heard it several times, people talking about a sense of place. And Roger was the first one I ever heard say that. He talked about having a sense of place. Way back in the dim ages, he said it. And now everybody's talking about having a sense of place and identity and everything else. But I want you to know, if you hear that, Roger was the first to use that term. And with that, I'll turn it over to Roger. Okay.
You know, Bob, I think ultimately I may end up sitting on that chair. Okay. There you go. Okay, but I'll start right now. Okay, thanks for coming. Do I need this?
Yes, no?
I do. Okay, here we go. Leave some lights on, please. Hello? I just want to start, okay, we'll get going here, and that this sort of talk evolved basically for last year, the Whitehall sesquicentennial, and Tanya Kabbala, people who did that sesquicentennial committee, if you're here, raise your hands, because basically they did an outstanding, wonderful job for the 150th anniversary of Whitehall. Very, very well done. And meeting after meeting and event after event. Anyway, so, you know, it starts out so innocently. Tanya says, you know, Roger, do you have any ideas for a program for next year for the sesquicentennial? I said, oh, yeah, let's do something maybe, because I'm interested in architectural history and things like that. And also, I said, okay, maybe we'll do something in Whitehall's changing architectural styles. And her comment was, oh, that's wonderful, you know. And then little did I know what that involved, all right. And so the other thing, she said, okay, anything else? And I said, well, you know, I've kayaked with Tanya, and so you kayak along the waterfront and things like that. And I said, okay, we will do a kayak tour of the historic waterfront of Whitehall. And so, okay, so we met, and then we had this little squabble. She wanted to put it in at the White River Bridge, and I thought, you know, they'll be dispersed with the current in 5 minutes. I said, we'll put it in at the Maple Grove Beach in Montague. And she said, but that's in Montague, you know. Anyway, so we lodged on the sand at the beach in Montague and paddled over to the tannery and had a great time going up the river, and we talked about different things, the evolution of the tannery site and things like that. Actually, we had 25 kayaks and one canoe. And it was just a wonderful, breezy afternoon, and we went up the river. So that's kind of the way we go. And then, as I mentioned, I didn't realize, you know, you had to take the morning shots when the sun was on this side. You had to take the afternoon shots when the sun was on that side of the street. And then, basically, I'm the old-timer that you'd grab some slides, you put them in a Kodak carousel, you go and you give a talk, right? Well, those days are over, and you've got to be keynote or PowerPoint or la-di-da mumbo-jumbo. And so all of a sudden you're totally crippled. I'm a techie dummy. And so that gets me to John and Sherry Calkins. And also John works for MasterTag. He's absolutely brilliant. And so the work you're going to see basically on the screen is the work of John Calkins. He and Sherry are on their way back to Georgetown in Washington for a wedding tomorrow or over the weekend. So they couldn't do that. So my substitute is my neighbor down the street, Jason, who's sitting here by the computer. So thank you, Jason. Because all of a sudden you're just hopelessly crippled, you know, when you want to do something. And I really don't feel old, but like I'm just an old techie dummy, you know, and you hate to have that label. Let's see where we're going. Anyway, I feel like, you know, we're all here because we live at White Lake, and we're very fortunate to live in a special place. And Norm had, you know, that feeling, sense of place, and I feel very strongly about sense of place. And then also, you know, I have a city planning background, landscape architecture, real estate, historic architecture, preservation work, mostly in California. A lot of great, interesting chapters, and also some travel. And along the way, you pick up on things. And one of the things I picked up on, especially in the city planning world, is like, the more we know about a place, the people, the events, the buildings, the more we respect and protect the place. So basically, and that's one of the roles, I think, of the historical society almost, is like, you know, we're getting ready for the next public hearing. I don't know where it's going to be or what it's going to be on, but somehow we're going to know something about the place, and we're here to protect and somehow improve the place. So, we will look at some residential buildings. We're going, little things, there's words now like sustainable, green, words like that, and that, you know, when you start looking around the city, the grid system is there, north, south, east, west, and, you know that the, there was a one, Nancy Fry put together a ceremony at Hill's Landing one time when they dedicated that. And I've never forgotten it. They had they had the Indians there, all right? And they had like, it almost, it was a religious actually aspect, because basically they had a smoking urn, all right? And the smoke was coming up like this. And we're standing there on the banks of White River at Hill's Landing. And they said, you know, to the north, where the great, you know, forces of whatever, and then, you know, to the south, wherever, and the smoke is swirling around, right? And then to the west, where the sun sets, and to the morning sun of the east, etc. And so, you know, we have, I think we've been encouraged by, like, electrical companies just to plug in, don't worry about it, but somehow we've forgotten north, south, east, west. So when we go through these slides, you'll see some, just how the pioneers and the old people kind of handled all this. It's very interesting. So I'm going to have to read some of the things that are also on this. So I think I'll sit down here a moment. I don't know what that does to you back there, but here we go, Jason. Let's go. Okay. Okay, this is the second slide, right? Yeah, okay. Beginning, this is architectural change insight. Okay, Whitehall's early development, housing type, street scenes, continuing design principles. Okay. Okay, Whitehall, as we know, is all named for Mears, Charlie Mears, platted in 1859, founded by Charles Mears and Giles Slocum, who bought the land from Captain John Hansen, who went out to live in suburbia and Claybanks. And hold on a minute. Back up. Okay. Some of the north-south streets were named after the Mears family members, and some east-west streets were named after the Slocum family. And so if you look, you see things like there's Sophia, Alice, etc. And I always love Spring Street, because if you ever walk along the bottom of the, you know, bum by the bike trail, there's always a big puddle, and that's because that's where Spring Street has the spring that comes out at the end of Spring Street. Okay. Okay, then here's the, you know, maybe we could hit some of the lights. Bob, back there, it might help a little. No? Those wonderful, you know, in 1880, they didn't have airplanes, but somehow they always have these atlases, which are in Montague and Whitehall and elsewhere. But this is like, you know, City of Whitehall, 1880. And, you know, on the earlier Mears Platt, you see there's no connector between Montague and Whitehall, and obviously they run the choo-choo train across, and then also the buggy path, the Colville Mills there is on the lower left-hand side, and the ships at sea. And matter of fact, can we go back to that one map, the Mears map? This is interesting, because somehow, from a planning point of view, everyone's always looking to build some, whether it's a Metropolitan Museum of Art or whatever in Central Park, etc. So in the original Mears Platt, there are two squares. There's Slocum Park, and then this park over here, all right? The first thing that happens is that this becomes the site of the high school, and the school for the city of Whitehall. And then, obviously, we're here in the city hall on this square here. But to compensate, obviously, the city of Whitehall has extensive waterfront development and sort of a wonderful park system along the water now. Okay. And again. Okay. This is interesting, because I was thinking, you know, like, here are the women in white. They are their 11th annual fair of the Garden Party of the Congregational Ladies' Aid Association, July 29th, 1915. And if you look at this, We'll compare this later on also, but like, that's a wonderful Mark Koval house. And at the building in the background with the square windows, brick facade, that's Ruth Perkins' building, 108 South Mears, which we all know. And then this is the old Mark Koval. Koval was a big name. And I was thinking as I was looking at this picture recently that somehow Montague currently has the women in black on Friday afternoon. And here the Congregational Ladies are the women in white in 1915. Okay. The housing types, okay, there's vernacular, the Michigan T type, Greek Revival, Gothic Revival, Italianate, Queen Anne, Classic Box, that was one of the awards we just gave, Craftsman, Bungalow, and then some period revivals, French Revival, Colonial Revival, English Cottage. Okay, vernacular architecture, there's a term that somehow when you don't really quite know what to say about what it is, you call it vernacular. And vernacular architecture is based upon methods of construction which use locally available resources and traditions to address local needs. Vernacular architecture tends to evolve over time to reflect the environmental, cultural, and historical context of which it exists. Okay, traditional rural or small town dwelling. Do you think I have to read all these things, or can you? You're all right. Yeah, okay. Anyway, not subject to fashion. Also, it's just a very direct thing. And so I refer to it also as a Michigan T, because basically there's always one gable and then there's another intersecting gable. Okay. And a classic example of that, who we gave an award to, are Jim and Terry Staples, the old Staple House. They're the seventh generation who have occupied this building, crossing the Playhouse Theater. We all know where it is. But then also how things change over time in different fashions. And so, you know, here you have the screen porch, which is on the south side. You have the bay window, which is Italianate kind of bracketing and detail, which would have been added later. That faces the east. Obviously, you get up in the morning, you get your coffee, you go in the dining room, you sit there in that bay window and, you know, watch the buggies go by. Also, hey, flip back a moment. And okay, because it's the next one. Okay, go ahead. And again. Okay. Yeah, this was interesting because basically they're remnants, and they're pretty much all gone now because of street widenings. But like, this is the Staples house years ago. And then there's the buggy things, which you step up here, and they call them carriage blocks. And we had one next to our house on Old Channel Trail, which came out when they put new curbs and gutters in. Okay. Sustainable living, and then this is a wonderful example of basically this is the back of, you know, go out and walk around these places. You know, it's all public access and things like that. You don't have to trespass on the property, but you just walk down the streets. This is taken like from the back alley, and so there's the slanted roof building with a pyramidal roof. That's the old tank house. There's a pub in the little courtyard there. The fruit cellar, which you put things during the winter for preservative, etc., is the yellow brick building, and then the different wings of the house. Okay. There's the Italianate bay window I mentioned was added, and then you can look at the porch and say that looks kind of 1920s kind of bungalow style that faces south. Okay. And then other people, how they handle just kind of street scenes, that Michigan T intersecting gable. There's usually a two-story gable and then maybe a one-story wing. Here we have obviously front porches start out and then slowly front porches get enclosed. Another example of that. Okay. And then this is a house supposedly which was at the Whitehall Bank area site at the Colby and Mears, and then was a Koval boarding house, which was then moved to Division Street by the old Congregational Church. And then also how things angle change over time. You can sort of see the 1950 porch posts, etc., which was obviously what you did then. Okay. But then even that, like the porch post over time and then the Italianate bays, oddly enough, are on the north side rather than the south side. Okay. More gable end, gable wing kind of thing. Sweet little building down there in Swedentown. Intersecting gables, you can see how it all works, and also a pyramidal roof kind of over the one wing gable. Here we come. Prowled around Swedentown. And also, when you do this, you know, you're taking photographs and someone wants to know, are you the assessor? Are you the guy who's foreclosing? Are you the bank? Why are you taking pictures of my house, etc.? So you have some interesting conversations along the way when you do this. But anyway, just, you know, just this is Swedentown again. But also the interesting porch detail there. Also, like the Historical Society has a tendency not to like vinyl siding because basically the vinyl siding will end up covering over any shingle detail, any interesting detail that may be on the building. And then also if water gets behind that, you're really in trouble and don't know it. Okay, next. Swedentown again, the front porch and the intersecting gables. But also, look at the window areas. The window, I mean, they didn't have light. I mean, we're talking candle, gaslight, kerosene, etc. And so windows and the size of windows were very important. Next. Cutie pie down there in Swedentown also. Like a little rural farmhouse, being sort of that intersecting Michigan T, the one, the base of the T, and then the wing going in the back, usually the kitchen wing. And then also, those sometimes they're just maybe one or two rooms wide, and you get a lot of cross ventilation because you didn't plug into air conditioning. I looked at this one and thought, I don't know about the roof detail. But anyway, just gables again. This one we've driven by many, many times. It's on Main Street going down through Swedentown. Wonderful little front porch. And the side, once again, that porch in the back would be facing west and also facing south. Warm spot. Okay. Another one down in Swedentown, been vinyled. House would have had originally like side lights and side windows. We'll see that when we come to Greek Revival. And probably more of a porch where that upper windows would have gone out to a little porch balcony. This is over on Mill Pond Road. Screen porch. Everyone in Michigan needs a screen porch. We learned that quickly. Okay. Across from City Hall right here. This to me kind of like a gable kind of treatment, but also an open kind of dormer upstairs. On the second floor, kind of reminds you of something you'd find down in like Louisiana or down south somewhere. Okay. More gable ends kind of thing. The intersecting gable in the center and then the front porch. The porch obviously enclosed in, over on the left over time. Window treatment, okay. This one, I worked for Harry Pillinger down at Skipper's Landing, and Harry and Stella lived in this house when they lived in town for a while, one of the first houses. Big bay window and the porch altered over time, and but the original window kind of things. Okay. This is interesting also, that intersecting gable where basically you could almost say, you know, if you look back at the house, that was the Koval house that was moved, kind of the same form, but obviously the big front bay window and then this rather elegant looking bin window over on the left, very kind of living room looking, and then that arch canopy over the entryway. Okay, just, you know, somebody thought those windows out, and also that curved. We'll see this curved entryway again and again, and obviously the porch posts you can say have been replaced by wrought iron rails, kind of thing. Okay, this is similar to like Gail's house over in the one we just gave the award over in Montague, but this is in Whitehall. And another one of those red brick houses, two-story, you know, gable front, and then with the side wing, gable side kind of thing. But also, once again, the generous scale of the windows. Okay. And then Greek Revival. Greek Revival, you know, I did some work for some friends on a landscape project in upstate New York. Upstate New York is just loaded with Greek Revival houses. And they usually have things like, it's this pediment here that gets the Greek treatment. And often, you've been to Marshall, Michigan? Yeah. Marshall has a great collection of Greek Revival houses. But then there'll be pilasters coming down here, often a little round window up there. Just a wonderful treatment. And then this very elaborate, the side lights, and then the lights around the door. We'll see that again and again. Okay. Anyway, this is Mac Hatch's house, the mayor. And that wonderful kind of canopy over the front door. Actually, Ruth Pitkin had this at one time also. Next. And to me, the real treasure of this house is that south-facing solarium. I mean, you want to call Mac and say, we're coming over on February 15th when the sun is out, and we're going to sort of sit there and watch the temperature go up to 80, you know? Because sunrooms do that, and this is the south side of the house. Doesn't take you long to figure that out. Okay. there's that sort of elaborate entrance again with the side lights and the lights over and that canopy. And then I think that's probably an award. We gave them an award, didn't we, once? Okay, I think maybe that's what's above that door. Okay, next. Right around the corner is a church building, and then this would be like the old parsonage. Very simple, very stark. And then, but if you go next, you see this, the side light door has that same Greek Revival treatment. Just kind of jazzing up that simple box form of the original vernacular building. Okay. And then here we go again, Greek Revival. You can sort of see that two-story open gable end connecting to a wing. Next. And then there's that same treatment. Obviously, the bracket at some time must have been taken away, but they knew you had to do something. So you did the little swirly gig above the pyramid kind of roof above here. This house, somehow told me it was like the house that belonged to Ollie G. And the G's were very prominent in Whitehall early on. And you see that side porch, which is a very kind of 1920s thing. You'll see that down at the White Sands Resort. You'll see that in Bob Wesley's old house over there in the Montague area, etc. The side lights, the canopy over the door, generous window areas, etc. And next. That same Greek Revival detail. Obviously, at some point in time, somebody enclosed the second floor. This one is over on Spring Street. Greek Revival again, altered. Next, I love that sign, do not enter. You know? Somehow you do. This is the bracket and also the side lights and overlights on the main entrance. But you can see where maybe there may have been more detail, but now it's been sort of screened and masked by the vinyl siding. Okay, Gothic Revival, constructed 1840, 1870, kind of goes on, and it's a steeply pitched roof, verge bards up in the area, you'll see details of that, interesting porch, intersecting gables, etc. Okay, and then this is, we gave an award, 2004. This is a house that basically friends Tom and Sue Tabor saved. It was an old Ruggles house. Ruggles had the yellow brickyard, which was located down there by the Chamber of Commerce. And if you walk on that trail going back to Norman Park, from the Chamber of Commerce building to Norman Park along that lower trail, you'll see where the hillside's been gouged out because there's a large hit of clay there. And so the clay was made into bricks by the Ruggles family. Ruggles was a very prominent kind of family in that area. Okay. There's a huge, wonderful oak tree. It's really kind of scary next to it. Okay. But just the, you know, the verge board and just the detail that somehow people put on a building. This is another, you know, okay, Gothic revival. And that front pyramidal roof, balcony, etc. And then this, the bay window is on the south side, welcoming, you know, the sunlight. The screen porch in the back, now enclosed, is also would have been like on the south side. The interesting thing about this house is that this is the house of Frederick Norman. And Frederick Norman was the painter who painted all those wonderful paintings that are located in the Whitehall Bank. And if you drive around, it's used as a rental now, but like if you drive around, you can see the plantings on the north side, which is adjacent to the street. And then there's this sort of garden spot, which is on the south side. And you just kind of know that somebody who knew about north, south, east to west, and light and shade, and art, Frederick Norman lived there. Okay. That's the Norman house on the left, and then this is the old DeWitt house over in Montague and Old Channel Trail. That same form. One of the things you pick up on as you drive around, you think, you know, I bet some guy built that house in Whitehall, might have built the house in Montague, kind of thing. Because you see similar things again and again and again. Okay. This is the Finch's Nest. We gave them an award in 2005. And you can sort of see the verge boards up in the upper areas, kind of an Italianate bay window, put together by the Finks and done a wonderful job. Next. Just the brackets. And it's just kind of fun, you know, you kind of walk along and you drive by these and you don't really take a look, but like you just kind of walk along, bike along, and you kind of observe things. There's an association also, if somebody wants to correct me, but I was told that this was always a tannery house, like the tannery manager lived there. And then there's a bigger piece of property. So if you drive by this house, you'll see kind of like a 1950s house on the left and a 1950s house on the right, which means that it would have been, those properties would have been split off later when the tannery probably sold the building to some other occupant. Here we go, the intersecting gables again, the steeply pitched roof. Might have been some verge board, might have been some detail, obviously. The international style in architecture just sort of ripped everything clean, and a very strange time. And anyway, we're getting over it now. Okay. This cute house over here, that front gable, that Gothic Revival kind of detail like we saw in those earlier buildings. And then also the other thing is like the porch, where the porch steps. There's always something about like White Lake houses where there's the front door, and then there's the back door, and like no one ever uses the front door. It's like the ceremonial thing, which maybe trick-or-treaters come to, but other than that, you know, no one really comes to. Go ahead. I also found this house kind of interesting from the idea that actually Ellie Dennis and Jim had this for a while and worked on this, and Pat Chambers, the photographer, and his wife had it. But you have that Gothic Revival detail, central gable, but then obviously somebody must have been, you know, there must have been a certain nagging going on. When the shingle detail comes along, like in Queen Anne, they want a Queen Anne gable on the end, etc. Also, the bay windows kind of Italianate, and but it has the old verge board up on top and the shingle detail, which evolved over a later time. Okay. Just an example of that side detail. Okay, the Italianate. A lot of... I lived out in San Francisco for many years in the Bay Area, and that kind of a form on the right is very typical of San Francisco, the Italianate. And they're usually two or three stories in a kind of a flat roof, pitched roof, often a false front. Anyway, 1850s, 1880s. Go ahead. This would have been, and that's interesting, things altered over time. This would have been an Italianate, and you can kind of see how there's that roof, the little roof deck, the widow's walk on top, and then just different detail, okay? Side detail. But once again, facing south, what faces south, there's the big sun porch on the south side. Also, the other side would face east, so I assume maybe those next two windows are probably a dining room, the back is probably a kitchen, so you grab your coffee, run out on the sun porch and have morning coffee kind of thing, okay? This kind of always captures my eye. It's the old King House. It's an Italianate that the arches over the windows, obviously a newer foundation next. And then this very elaborate entrance with, you know, the finials going up and going down, the curved arch, and then the pyramidal arch, and then obviously, you know, the later 1950s front porch kind of thing. Okay. Another Italianate altered over time. This would have been the old Neltus House. Neltus had a department store here on Main Street where Hokey Pokey is. And you can sort of see how the side porch, which would have faced south and would have faced west, has been altered over time. Okay. And then there's that arch detail again over the window. We'll see that again and again. And also the side lights, getting a little kind of like colonial revival, a Greek revival, but not quite. Okay. This one is the Lewis House, which is a great showman house kind of thing. And if you look carefully at this right now, you'll see there's the carriage house over on the right, which has been taken away. And then the house, you'll see it's an Italianate, but basically it has the front porch post, square post coming down. And then and the picket fence, and then the view out over the lake in the background. Okay. And it's interesting what happened. This obviously has evolved over time. At one time, it was a boarding, during the chemical era, it became sort of a boarding house. And so you enclose, you know, the one side porch, the other side porch. But the thing is, which I think is curious, is that it has, you know, the Gothic almost front gable thing, but the flat roof on top. But in 1893, everyone went to the Chicago World's Fair, the Columbian Exposition. It was the Great White City. And so when you came back from the fair, you had to have Greek columns or something with columns. And so you know that somehow the Lewises, who did not lack funds, obviously extended the Victorian porch around the side, and then put in the Greek columns. I talked to Greg, and we've kind of got a plan for recycling the columns, kind of similar to the one we saw down at the Timbers last year at the meeting, that wonderful pagoda on the side of the hill. Anyway, they're doing a very interesting job on this and taking it back. It's also now in the National Register. Okay. There's that front porch detail again, which has been changed back to the Italianate. If you drive by shortly, you'll see that. Okay. More porch, that was Colonial Columbian Exposition. Jackson Park, I mean, it was amazing what they did in the 1890. The 1893 World's Fair was to celebrate Columbian Exposition, Columbus's arrival in America. 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. Well, obviously they didn't get it together in 1492, so somehow the show happened in 1893. Okay. You can see how they have altered the side area, et cetera. Added foundations underneath, but handsome old house and a lot of care going into it now. J.C. Lewis. The other nice story about this is, I talk about this when we do that trolley tour, that the Lewises are related to the... John C. Lewis married Augusta Coville. Coville gets him into the lumber business. John C. Lewis also is in the lumber business. It's kind of that lumber dynasty kind of thing, chop it down. And but somewhere... his daughter is like Florence Hodges, and she lives in St. Louis, uses this as a summer house, because of the house that she was raised in for a long, long time. And then ultimately, when she dies, she leaves $1 million to the Hume Home in Muskegon for the housing for the elderly. And it, to me, it's always such a nice story, because basically a lot of the original money came back and then was donated for... the Hume Home, which is the housing for the elderly one, not the showcase house down by the Hackley House. But it's basically a wonderful place for senior citizens to occupy later on in life. Okay. These were more Italianates, which are along Mears. And the one in here in the right-hand side, pretty much still intact. The next one altered. The next one altered over time also. Okay. This is an old Italianate, but obviously altered over time. And it's kind of fun on this one, because basically you see those kind of prairie-style columns on the corner, and that this was a Pitkin house. And the Pitkins were sort of style makers in town, and also prominent citizens, drugstore, etc. Okay. Another view of that. Next. And then I thought, like, who did it first? Okay. Did the Pitkins do their front porch first, and then these people did it second, or the same contract? But anyway, this is Dr. Meinhardy's house further on down Mears. And you see that same kind of porch detail, that very kind of 19, almost kind of Frank Lloyd Wrighty, kind of early 1916, 1926 kind of detail. And then how the building's been sort of changed over time. This is where the building is that Helen Fink has been working on, which is now down by the... by the cave, down by the chamber, in the caboose, the Meinhardy building. Okay. Italianate. You can sort of see where there might have been a porch over the right-hand side, where the big window was. Also, you kind of wondered, did that guy have an office? Was that something going on there? But anyway, how the brackets on the upper story are still there, the brackets on the lower floor over the windows are gone. The front porch has been altered, kind of like probably 1950s, 60s. Okay. But you can see that Italianate form there on this house. Okay. Front porch detail changed. Okay. And then here's that curved arch again over the windows. And then this was another sort of prominent citizen. This was like the Coville-Radcliffe, obviously the Coville family coming together with Radcliffe. Radcliffe, they were always in charge of the tannery. And so if you drive around Grand Rapids, you'll see houses where like old Italianate houses have been colonialized, because somehow Grand up on Heritage Hill, you see a lot of changes like that. Okay. Here's the old Italianate here on the left. That's where Louis Berman, who had the Whitehall Forum for years. The bay window facing south, good detail. Oddly, there's a funny little window that would have been a total window, but now the upper portion is glass block. And then the other Coville building next to it over there on the right. Okay. Another Italianate. This is down on Mill Pond Road. You can kind of see how it's been altered over time. Probably 1950s kind of windows put in, and just changes over time. This one has a very elaborate front yard scene, and on Division, and Italianate form. You know, the people who received the award on Mary Bead Street noticed, like, they put some brackets back up on the building, and the brackets obviously on this building either weren't there or were taken off at some point of time, front porch altered, etc. Okay? Here's the bracket, the wonderful Italianate bay on this building. Handsome old house, one story, and just faces west, gathers a lot of sun, etc. You got a no kitchen, dining room, and I don't know what after that in front. Okay. Handsome old Italianate detail. Okay. And this is one we gave an award to in 2008. This is Elise Dodge's old house. And Elise Dodge was a teacher, very prominent member of the Historical Society, and is now owned by Rilema Landman family. And just a one-story Italianate, just kind of great little house. Okay. Side bay windows, also with the screen porch on the back side, the south side, and the west side. Okay. And then the back, how it kind of merges into the lawn area, etc. The house we saw earlier over there on the right. This is on an alley, sort of an L-shaped piece of property. Actually, drive right by this, and you can see the screen porch. It's enclosed, where they haven't taken down the summer stuff or the winter stuff to protect the porch over there on the left. Okay. Also, I did this in the spring. And there's the Bradford pears, and you see different plant material that's coming out, the yews, et cetera. We'll get more into that later on. Okay. The old little sweetie pie down there in Swedentown, and actually not in Swedentown, I guess I'd call it Bunker Hill. Just one-story Italianate, very simple. And go ahead. And also, you want to say, you know, like, in this case, the living area is probably on the right-hand side. The bedrooms and maybe a bathroom are on the left side, and which kind of ignores the living spaces on the south side, which you somehow want to have your living spaces on the south side because it's warmer and more congenial and sunny, et cetera. Okay.
Do you think the thing at the back is an add-on?
Oh, the back wing, yeah, I would think, yeah.
So that original house, how many square feet do you think that is?
I have no idea. It looks like, I don't know, what, 30 by 30?
It's really small, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it's small, yeah. But they usually did have sort of a wing in the back. And then here's that same form again, the Italianate one-story. And you can sort of see where there's the back area. This was an old Ruggles house also across from Mac Hatch's. And then the porch area, which would have been put in later on. This sort of gets into sort of the Italianate form sort of merging. It would be what they call Second Empire. And also the mansard roof. This is, you know, getting close to Swedentown, but not quite. And also the Italianate bay, which is over here on the right. But that faces north, actually, and the south side is, go ahead, is that side, which you can see where they put in some sliding doors and attempt to go out to a terrace or something to be on the sunny side of the house. Actually, it's kind of unique because it's basically the only mansard roof house I've seen around Whitehall. Okay. Down in Swedentown again, that Italianate form, the wing on the back, the enclosed front porch. Okay. This one's right across the street from us in City Hall here. Italianate form, square. And you start looking at this thing, like, there was some guy who did build all these things together, you know. Was this Mr. Schultz? Or, you know, often it's interesting because, like, you can't generalize like this, but you want to label stuff like the Swedish people were like always kind of carpenters, craftspeople, etc. And, you know, was this built by Johnny Swenson or Johnny Johnson or something, you know? One kind of wonders the name. Okay, a brick. Red brick, as a matter of fact. Italianate form, that same square form, pyramidal roof with the big addition on the back. Original front porch, actually, is probably still there with the original porch posts. Okay. Same, you know, the pyramidal roof, same form. This Peter Dam has this over there next to his shop. Okay. This is out on Mill Pond Road, same kind of Italianate form. Front porch, obviously, probably removed. Italianate form, okay. This is interesting because the previous slide, we saw the magnolias over on the right-hand side, and then here's a kind of the weeping cherry. And then this the front faces south, and then you would have that porch, which probably would have been screened in at one time, which would be facing the face, the west, and also the back, overlooking the mill pond, actually, okay? Queen Anne. This is sort of, you know, the money starts rolling in, and so we're talking 1880 and the 1890s. And like the Hackley House would be an example of Queen Anne architecture. You know, steeply pitched roof, patterned shingles, strange facade, no simple one gable end like a Greek revival, okay? And the example of that would be this house, which was the, Charlie Siegler House. He was also the kind of like the music director, etc., involved with the Playhouse Theater. But you see that sort of round tower, the shingle detail, the open funny little gable up on top. The front porch has been altered over time, but still very much intact. Some of the detail. Also, often they would have windows that curved, and somehow, if you ever broke one, you're in trouble. This is another house. This is across from the Playhouse, across from the old Bloomdale House, behind the Staples House, and that Victorian Queen Anne style. The turrets, you know, similar to stuff you'd see at the Hackley House. Front porch removed. This is the old Pack Rat building. Bernard was a doctor who lived there. The George Byam's parents lived there. He's raised there, and. And it's currently on the market, okay? But nice location up overlooking the water, and also they closed off the street here and made a wonderful kind of pedestrian way landscaped on the way down. Towering on the hill, you know, the haunted house. Anyway, another one, this is the bed and breakfast. Gave an award in 2005. This was another, once again, the word Koval. This is a Koval house. And sort of Queen Anne in style with also a lot of Italianate detail and bracketing, okay? There's that Italianate bay window facing the south side, the screen porch. Ron and Kathy Russell have this now and have done a wonderful job on it, okay? Just south facing over the lawn, and the other side is sort of the cold side, okay? Detailing brackets. You see that bracket again a lot in those Greek revival houses with the different bracket and scroll work. Okay. There we go again. Another Queen Anne. This is the old Newfer House, which has been moved back. And it was sort of closer to the street, had a lot more sort of Victorian kind of Queen Anne detail, has been somewhat cleaned up, and also added a great back kitchen wing, etc. Bush Creek goes along the side. Also, it's interesting, you can sort of see, it looks what probably is a magnolia tree over there on the right-hand side. Bush Creek then goes down into what'll be the tannery property behind it. Okay.
That maple blow down?
Pardon?
That maple tree. Is that the one that blew down?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay, might have happened, yeah.
Yeah, blew down.
Okay.
Took the lights out.
And the classic box. This is one we just gave an award to. You'll see that on the panels over there on the left. Norm also said it was maybe a Sears and Roebuck house. Classic box. It's kind of a four-square situation. And next. And then this is the house we gave the award to this year. And this, Norm, if I'm right, this was an Esterling house, right?
Right.
And Esterling, once again, they were Kovals. And for those who have been around, I somehow say things like this, and I say, oh, my God, I'm sounding like John Lettick, you know? But anyway, John knew so much. Anyway, that was moved. Here's another square house here. This is in the same block that the Frederick Norman house is located in. Interesting gable up in the dormers up on the roof, but obviously the square-shaped, and then all the integrity of the structure is still very much there. This is down in Swedentown. Greg Johnson's daughter now lives there with her family. We drive by this a lot when you go down Main Street, okay? Wonderful kind of, you know, kind of Grecian almost front entryway, okay? Another one would be intersecting gables, et cetera, kind of Queen Anne style, but also there's that little kind of portico share thing on the side there where it comes out over the side steps. This is across the street from City Hall here. Another square, shingle detail up on top. Also the wonderful window up in the attic, that pyramidal triangular trapezoid thing. Okay. Craftsmen. We get into sort of the craftsmen, and they're craftsmen and bungalow, some kind of mixed together almost, but they sort of strut out in Southern California, Pasadena, great green and green, the architects out there, all over, low-pitched roof, gable rafters exposed on the ends, etc. Always a porch involved, battered columns, like you see the slanting columns on the front porch, okay? And then an example of this, which hopefully you've all been through, is like Larry and Lisa's Cocoa Cottage, excuse me, which we gave an award in 2004. Also a magnolia tree there in the front yard. Okay. Wonderful little side terrace, which is sort of privacy, facing south once again. Okay. Another craftsman crossing the Seeger House, which is over in Sophia. This would be in the same block as Clock's Funeral Home, but that sort of form of the craftsman. Okay, another craftsman house. Once again, their eyes and talent. And Carmi Garin was Garin's an old Sylvan Beach name, and very complicated story of the family, et cetera. Interesting story, and. House down at Sylvan, struck by lightning, burned, and then this is over in Mill Pond. It's a real drive-by. We gave it an award in 2007, overlooks the Mill Pond in the background. Wonderful dormer on the second floor, and handled very nicely. Just kind of that craftsman kind of aura about it. The side porch that faces west, okay. And there's an old garage building which the owners had some fun with. You know, putting the porch on, and once again, you can see the waters of the mill pond behind it, okay? And then the bungalow. You know, Bengal, India, and this somehow evolves. The Brits, obviously, we all remember in high school where you'd look at the map and everything was colored pink. Canada was pink, Australia was pink. Everything was pink, and pink was the color code for everything that was owned by the British Empire. And so the Brits were all over, and they bought back the bungalow. But you have those battered columns. Those battered columns were also all around the Montague Cemetery, which have been removed, but they're still around that one cemetery, the Sammis Cemetery, which is over on Eilers Road. Those battered columns. Okay, and then here's a whole little row of bungalows. And you can sort of see that up to the front porch, and then you know that going back to the other projecting dormer with that slanted roof that's called a Jurgen head roof. But anyway, you just know that somehow that's a little dining area or a dining room, and then the kitchen would be in back, capturing sun, etc. Okay? That's that house. And then the north side, obviously, is like, you know, bedroom, bathroom, bedroom, and a back kitchen wing or garage wing next. And then obviously, this is the one next to it, which has been sort of altered over time. I call this kind of like out in California, they did Sea Ranch, and everything had to be in lumber. And so this has been Sea Ranch-ized. But, you know, an interesting pergola, wisteria growing on the front pergola, and then the side garage on the north side. Okay. These were two companion houses over there, Division Street. Someone said Susan Treutler, who writes for the Chronicle, was raised in that house. But once again, you can sort of see there's a living room on the left-hand side, south side, north side, bedroom, bathroom, bedroom, full basement, near Biles Furniture is behind it, okay? Another bungalow, which would be, during my life, the Waller family lived there. You can see where the front porch has been enclosed, fireplace, and that the living room somehow with fireplace, and then back to the back porch, sun porch, etc., capturing sun. Wynton Betty Dahlstrom's old house right there in downtown Whitehall. Front porch, side projection, okay. Side projection is a dinette area. That's where you get your coffee and go in the morning kind of thing. But in this case, it faces west and also it touches south. Another one, bungalow out near the old Meinhardy house on Mears. Okay. Another bungalow, this is sort of a strange one, but anyway, this is the Red Fern Bloomdahl House, and Leonard and Edna occupied this for years. And it's made out of concrete block, rusticated concrete block. Very few concrete block houses are this rust. You see some garages like this over by the Montague Museum, but the concrete blocks were made by Tiemann, and Tiemann basically has ramped them across from the Montague City Hall. They made the rusticated concrete blocks. If you're ever out in the cemetery, they did a cemetery walk, the Lakeshore Museum, and there's a huge granite bench that somehow has a name Red Fern on it. And obviously the Red Ferns are rather prominent when they built this house. And then Leonard Edna. Leonard Edna also a wonderful, generous story because, you know, they gave a bundle of bucks. I don't know how, like $500,000, $800,000 to the White Lake Community Foundation. And Edna was, they were both very involved with the Playhouse Theater and also had a wonderful garden and a green thumb. Okay. This is the back. The deck has been added. But you used to go over there, and Edna was a wonderful lady involved in the city council and stuff like that, and I'm sure there's other people in this room. You would go there, and you would sit there in that window there where beyond the deck, you see the glass coming down. That's the kitchen table window, and that's where I'm sure many episodes of Whitehall history were formed at the Bloomdahl table there. Edna always hated the snapping halyards on the metal things. Didn't like that. But anyway, obviously the marinas down below. Okay. French Revival. We get in some revivals. We're coming into a later period, 1920s, 1930s. The French sort of the pitch roof, pyramidal roof, quoins usually on the corner, which are those block on the corners. We'll point out in a moment. Okay. And then this was, once again, the style setters, which were the Pitkins. And so this was Clarence Pitkin's last house, overlooking the ravine to the north, and then the front portico there faces the south. The quoins are the white things on the corner, etc. The pyramidal roof. Bill Gebhardt who was the granddaddy of landscape architecture, did the original landscape plan. Landscape plans, unfortunately, there's the next person or the third person in owners always wants to clean the place up and eradicates much too much stuff. But anyway, Bill Gebhardt was a landscape architect for the Pitkin House. Okay? That's the backside. Obviously, driving down underneath, garage underneath, and then the views out over the marsh, which would be very scenic. And also the interesting bracketing along underneath the eave line, etc. Okay? Ruth probably has many stories on this building. The front entrance. Colonial Revival. Once again, kind of like a 1920s, 1930s. Usually very symmetrical. Window on this side, window on that side. Center door, pediment, some dormers on the second floor, double hung windows, that sort of thing. Okay. And the example of this basically is the Alvin Ljungquist house down there in Swedentown. Alvin Ljungquist was raised in Whitehall, ended up having a career in Ohio, Toledo, I think, teaching. But one of his claims to fame was that he's the designer of the Y-Flyer, which raced for many years down at the Yacht Club. Also, Alvin Ljungquist was very much involved with the White Lake Yacht Club Sailing School, and a real key factor in keeping that thing going. And just a very simple, straightforward house. Garage, obviously, added more later on. Okay. There's that symmetrical facade, and just interesting kind of Colonial Revival. Another example, altered over time, would be the old house Mellentil Dahlstrom had. Clock Funeral Home is behind it. Okay. This one, Colonial Revival, also across the street here. Not totally symmetrical, but obviously this was a Dahlstrom. They were also involved with the Pitkins and sort of tastemakers in early Whitehall. Okay. Cutie Pie here, this is out on Mears again, and you know, everything that's Colonial Revival, symmetrical facade, symmetrical dormers, wonderful kind of picket fence, plant material, etc. Okay. This is another Colonial Revival. You can see where the front porch has been altered over time, and maybe the garage would have been on the left, and then there was been like a sunroom or something on the south side where the chapel is. And there's an interesting story. When we did Days of Yore here last year, some members, this was a G house, Ruby G lived here, and And there's a wonderful story which the G family refers to as the incident. And during the 1930s, we're basically, I feel kind of gossipy, but Ruby G had they adopted a son named Foster. And Foster and Ruby, I don't know what, I won't say what, but ever, she was there with her boyfriend, and the boyfriend was being sort of abusive, and he was a writer for the Grand Rapids paper. And so the kid said, you know, stop bashing my mother or whatever, I will shoot you. And the guy just continued, and so he went upstairs and got a shotgun and came down and shot the guy and basically killed him. And so I was curious about that story, and so the members of the G family who were here last year for that Deja Vior program said, oh, we'll send you the clipping. And so it's like, I'll say 1934, 1936, somewhere in there. And this house basically was, there was a craftsman house in the back, and the rest of the block was all a very thick woods. Edna Bloomberg said they used to have like a Chautauqua festival there in a tent here in the woods, which the whole block, basically except for one lot, was owned by the G family. And anyway, it's now an offshake. I love the sign out in front. It says clocks, and the clock is ticking as you drive by. La da la. Okay. Anyway, English Cottage. Another, you know, along with revivals, kind of steeply pitched roof. Different gables, etc. This also you'll see over there on the corner, on the wall over there, the Fritches. We gave an award to recently. Bud and Aline Fritch did wonderful work on old houses. This house was never really neglected. I guess the name of Dr. Besong, a dentist in town, goes with this. But somehow the Fritches in back added a deck, they added a garage, and did some improvements on the back. Has a very nice kind of deep garden in the back. And so Bud and Aline Fritch also worked on this. Their Bud and Aline Fritch's clue is that anything you see with sort of dark brown shingles has involved Bud and Aline Fritch. The Ferry Memorial House, which they tore down at the top of the hill, further on down in Maple Grove, Carol Brantois' house, down on Indian Bay Road, etc. You'll see the pictures over there on the side. Okay. Anyway, there we are, the intersecting gables, steeply pitched roofed, English Revival, okay, cottage. Meinhardy House across the street, there's that same arching kind of colonial aspect. And then that wing on the right, it was added later on. Sort of a handsome main old facade there. Okay, street scenes. We're almost through. Street scenes. The bungalow street scene. Okay. We hear the old Italianate. You know, the Italianate, Mears would have been like old Channel Trail. Like we have an old Italianate over there in Montague. And the interesting thing from a city planning point of view about Whitehall versus Montague in planning jargon is that somehow the business section of Montague is down below the hill, all right? And that somehow there's a geographic, you know, separation of hillside, bluff, lower lowlands. And that somehow, and then Montague is like away from the main freeway route to Muskegon. So obviously Montague drives through Whitehall on the way to the freeway. And so what happens is that basically, you know, you want to start doing commercial enterprises. So Mears and Colby have ended up having this confusion. Is it residential? Is it commercial? What is it? And that somehow when you drive down Old Channel Trail, you know, it's definitely residential, and the city, it was all zoned multifamily once, but somehow they wisely altered it back. And so it's just that confusing. You know, if Joe Goodbody, if we give him that, well, obviously then the next lot is going to get it because you've set your precedent. And so it just marches down Mirror Street. It marches down Colby, kind of zoning questions. Don Sandell's here from Fruitland Township, right? Hi, Don. Okay, another street scene. Okay. That's another old Pitkin house, as a matter of fact, before they moved over to the bluff. Okay. Plantings. Magnolias, springtime. There was some great stuff you see in driving around. Wonderful old plant material. Okay. Flowering dogwoods. Flowering dogwood again. Cercis canadensis, redbud, Judas tree. Copper Beech, Edna Bloomdahl's. Okay. that wonderful oak tree there by Tom and Sue's house over there, the old Ruckles house, okay? Barns and alleys, and if there's some zoning administrators here from Whitehall, like, you know, go easy on these buildings, because basically they're wonderful old buildings, they're horse and buggy buildings, and they're still here. And obviously here's board and batten, and, you know, the big gable with the side shed roof on the side, okay? Same thing, you know, main gable, shed roof on side. Drive down the alleys in Whitehall. They're very interesting. Main gable, lean-to, and a lean-to, lean-to extended kind of thing, okay? This is across the street from us, actually. And we want to say, maybe we ought to clear up some of those trees and treat that baby right, okay? Taking care of, I don't know, okay? There's the Tiemann block again, like Edna and the Bloomdahl house. This is over there on Colby. Another old barn building. I mean, we're talking horse and buggy days here, and there's the hay loft up above. They've got the door open because they're waiting for more hay, okay? Gambrel roof, you know, Dutch Colonial usually has that gambrel roof, and there's very few of those in the Whitehall area. But that one, I thought, you know, like, you know, as a kid, you'd love to have a great room like that upstairs. And also, I'm sure parents would love to throw their kids in a room like that upstairs. But handsome old building. And they're just kind of, you know, just plant material that comes up, and there's the old kind of like garage with tar paper on it. Okay, where'd the Goodwins go? Right there is the Linderman house. Then there is a Koval house, etc. Next. Another house here. The house in the corner was moved back by the old school building. Okay. The Linderman house, I came back from California when I lived out there, and Lynn and Walter Snyder had the old Ripley house, which is currently on the market, and we have to find somebody good for it on Old Channel Trail. Big yellow brick Italianate, now used as a daycare. But anyway, I came back, and you'd always go over and have a gin and tonic with Lynn and Walter Snyder. Lynn was sort of the culture lady who brought the ballet classes, ballroom dancing classes, et cetera, et cetera. Walter was organist of the Episcopal Church, and like their son went to Juilliard and then became a lawyer later after the University of Michigan. Libby's still a musician out in L.A. But these are all fragments from the Linderman house, which was across the street from basically kind of like Ruth Pitkin's building right by the alley. And so the finial there would have been up in the gate. It's upside down, but like you could see where it would be like the King house up there at the point. And so I did a quick sketch and gave it to Walter and said, you know, just kind of make it like a little dummy facade, kind of New Orleans kind of thing. Just kind of work the building details, and just it'll just be a stage facade. And so those are all parts from the old Linderman house that was torn down in Whitehall. And then that's where the wonderful Mark Koval house was. There's, you know, the Ruth's building over there on the right. Ruth, there's your controversial tree. And okay, next. And then here we have, once again, the ladies in white, and that's the old Mark Koval house. You always remember, like, when you were a kid walking to the Playhouse Theater to see Hopalong Cassidy or something like that, you'd glance in the window, and there was, like, these huge oil paintings at the back of a big window. And obviously, once again, Koval, very prominent name in Whitehall, okay? And then this was the site of another Koval house in Staples. Jim Staples talks about this. This belonged to the Staples Koval family, which was bulldozed for the post office, okay? And then across the street from the Lewis house was another wonderful old Italianate Victorian. And that stood for a long time, became a boarding house, and then they did an L-shaped motel around it, then ultimately tore down the Italianate Victorian, which is now the Green Lawn. And then the Playhouse Theater survives and stays, and thank goodness Whitehall stepped up to the plate and took on the responsibility of that. Okay. Next. Just sensible lot patterns. You know, you don't have to call in the lawn service. You know, I'm a very, if you drove by where I live, you'll say, where the hell is the lawn? And the answer is, there isn't. And lawns are just a waste of time. You know, I see Connie running the mowers on Coble Park, you know, 8 days a week kind of thing. And you just want to see the hillside by the Riverview Cafe or whatever they call it now. You know, why do you cut that? Stupid. Just stop. You know, just let it grow. And anyway, there's this fascination. And, you know, there are people who I'm sure will go home tomorrow and start blowing wet leaves because somehow they're on the lawn. But it's just a waste of time. But anyway, I always kind of like this as a kind of a front entry yard, just kind of like low-growing perennials, shrub treatment, etc. This is down in Swedentown. We saw it earlier. And then Mac's place, you know, orientation, that wonderful south-facing room, etc. Okay? Sustainable living, we just kind of, you know, like point to north, south, east, west, and also don't plug in, try to work without plugging in. I mean, like, I don't have air conditioning. And, you know, like, we've raised a whole generation that somehow believes every house has to be air conditioned. And you think, like, what's all that about? But then, at the same time, they're all environments and they don't want to have no more nuke plants, you know? So we've got to start thinking about sustainable living. And I think next. Okay, that's the end. So I'll say if there's, like, we can turn the lights on. And Jason, thank you for doing that. If you have any questions, very happy to answer any questions and hopefully have kind of hit it all. And then I would encourage you to basically just get out and walk up and down the streets. Take a look and see what's there. And there's a lot of interesting stock out there. And it's a visual feast, so go out and explore it. Anyway, thank you. Questions? Okay. Mr. Narm, you're next.
No one has a question of Roger? I can't believe that.
Yeah, that always means you bombed if nobody asks a question.
Well, since I tell you about one old barn here, and I drove 407 South Lincoln to my old house. And the only way to keep that barn, I had to replace the roof.
Okay.
To keep the barn, or they said I had to tear it down. So I'm glad I kept the roof.
Yeah, because, you know, the other clue, you go through this with somebody who has an old house. You know, if you have an old building and there's a building that needs some help, you know, before you tear it down or alter it, go check the city and see what you can do, because basically you will go to the city and they'll say you need a 25-foot front setback, you need a 10-foot side yard setback. Baby, you're out of business. You can't use that building anymore. So, like, don't tear it down until you explore all the alternatives, because otherwise you'll never get it back. Okay.
You mentioned abstracts. How would we find that about our house? Where would that come from?
Sorry, what?
An abstract?
Yeah, abstract of title. Unfortunately, what happened was abstract of title was something which, you know, it was almost automatic work for the attorney, because basically every time a property sold, you had to clear title. And so the title, it would go from a U.S. government to somebody, and then ultimately to Charlie Mears, money would go to the Ferry family, and then continue on. And then they had to track everybody down. And that they stopped doing that, and they now have title insurance. And so you could go to a title company, or you could go down to the courthouse and look at the old courthouse records, right? Pardon?
Registered deeds.
Yeah, the registered deeds would have something, and it's like there'll be book and page, and you kind of follow up on that. Bruce, do you have something?
No.
Oh, okay.
You would go into the index by owner of the seller and the buyer. They'll maintain two parallel indexes. If you know your own ownership and one or two before you, that'll get you started, and then you can work your way backwards.
Hey, that's Bruce. He's an attorney. And actually, Margot Haynes is next to him. Margot did the wonderful newsletter you just got, The Sheet of Blue. So thank you, Margot. Okay, who else? What else?
Anyone? Huh?
Okay.
If you don't think Roger has some definite opinions about these things, I'll tell you, also, there's Sharmer Drive. Roger sent me a picture of that a couple years ago and labeled it as the heartland of Michigan's industrial miters. And that's Roger. Folks, keep moving on here, we've got just a few more things, and we'd like to get them wrapped up because we've got some cider and some other munchies and coffee, and we certainly wouldn't want those to go to waste. Roger mentioned the Youngquist House. I don't need that. Elvin Youngquist and the Y Flyer, and I brought some stuff. I've been trying to pull through my stuff, and I've got some old Y Flyer bulletins, if anyone is interested. I also have two or three different copies of articles about Ruth Thompson. And I got those when we were working on getting Ruth nominated into the Michigan Women's Hall of Fame. They came out of the Chronicle Board. And the Chronicle, like so many papers, no longer allows public into the board because, unfortunately, people were going in there with razors and cutting out articles. And so you have to find someone who is a good contact that works there. And I did that and managed to get copies. And these were some extras. If anybody would like to take them and look at them, please do, because I'm trying to get that stuff organized. Now, I'm not in too big a hurry because my wife says I'll die before I get organized. So I'm not pushing it too hard. Ruth is back there nodding her head.
Look at the Norm. Look at the pictures over there. The first, the largest poster Jeannie Reeves and I made of the driving tour, and there are some things that you can pick up if you want to see some of the old houses that we've given awards to.
Okay.
And then the